Okay, good afternoon everybody. I hope all of you reviewed the last lecture. So the most important thing of the last lecture is we characterized the differentiability at a point in terms of some continuity. That is a very, very useful trick. It avoids a lot of inequalities, etc. And it's also the general pattern of mathematics. You reduce a problem to some problem which you had already seen, or adapt the method to solve a newer problem. Okay, that's what you are doing. So let me share the screen. So do all of you remember the characterization? So what do I have? I have function f from an interval j to R, A is a point in R. Sorry, A is a point in J. And we say F is differentiable at A. If there are two definitions we had already seen. Actually, three if you want. Okay. So, it's if limit X tends to A of Fx minus fa by x minus a exists, and the limit, if it exists, we denote by f dash a and call it the derivative of f at a. Okay, and we said this equivalent definition is there is a function f1 from j to r. I call it an auxiliary function. So that, what are the two things? F of x must be equal to f of a plus f1 of x into x minus a. This is true for all x in j. In particular, if x is not equal to a, we have an explicit expression for f1 of x. And two, f1 must be continuous at a. If this happens, then the derivative then f1 of a is the limit of x tends to a of fx minus fa by x minus a. In other words, this is f dash a. Okay, this is the characterization we have seen. Now what I want to do, yesterday I already gave some few examples. I'll come back to examples again. But before that, we want to talk about algebra of differentiable functions. What does that mean? Like you must have seen algebra of convergent sequences, algebra of continuous functions, sum of two convergent sequences is convergent, sum of two continuous functions is continuous, and product of two convergent functions is, convergent sequences is convergent, product of two continuous functions is continuous, and so on and so forth. Similar thing is what you want to do. So let us fix the notation. As usual, J is an interval, A is a point fixed at that. So let F and G from J to R be differentiable at A. Okay, this is the assumption. Then one, F plus G is differentiable at A. And also F plus G dash at A is F dash A plus G dash A. And two, F time G is differentiable at A, and F G dash at A is F at A just 1 second, somebody is waiting. Let me just do something about him. Oh, his signal is extremely bad. Okay. F at A and G dash A plus F dash A into G A. right? And next is something truth. Suppose f at a is not equal to 0, then 1 by f is differentiable at a. And we have to find the derivative. Okay. And the easier thing I have forgotten, if c is a constant and c times f is differentiable at a. So these are what is called algebra. Okay, because you are talking about addition, you are talking about multiplication, you are talking about scalar, and you are talking about taking reciprocals. Is it okay? Right. We had already done one, that's the easy one. Let's do the two one. Suppose f is differentiable, I have to prove fg is differentiable. Right? So how do I prove fg is differentiable? We plan to use the second condition, the characterization. What is this characterization? The characterization says, in terms of the auxiliary function, we have to do that. So let us call phi equal to f times g. How do I define f times g? It is a function from j to r, and I have to tell you what is its value at x. This must be a real number. Now fx is a real number, gx is a real number, therefore you define it to be fx into gx. This is the definition. You understand? It's not automatic. We are defining. We know how to multiply two real numbers. That allows us to define multiplication of two functions. You should think of it that way. Don't just like that think it's obvious. Okay. Now what do I want to do? So if I want to say it's differentiable, then I have to say phi x equal to, I have to write something like that, phi a plus phi 1 of x into x minus a for all x in j, and phi 1 must be continuous at a. I have to find such a phi 1. Do all of you understand? So what do you think I should do? Can somebody tell me what I should do now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Who is this?
We can,
Jyoti. Yeah, tell me. Yeah.
Yes, sir. We can define f of x equal to f of a plus f1x.
Right. We use the auxiliary function for f and auxiliary function for g and try to do algebra. That's all. Sir. You are right. Thank you. This is fx. Since f is differentiable at a, I know that I can write fx equal to f of a plus f1 of x into x minus a. This is for all x in j, where f1 is continuous at a. Similarly, I can do for gx. This will be g of a plus g1 of x into x minus a. Do all of you understand? Therefore, what is phi of x? That is fx into gx. But that is equal to, you have to multiply the whole thing. Am I making sense? Therefore, fa into ga, right, fa into ga, then fa into g1x into x minus a plus ga into f1x into x minus a. Do all of you understand that? So I'm writing as a shorthand, fa into g1x plus ga into f1x, the whole thing multiplied by x minus a, plus then I have to multiply f1x x minus a, g1x x minus a. That is going to give me f1x g1x into x minus a whole squared. Do all of you understand this? But what is fa into ga? This is phi of a. Right? So let us look at what should I do? I should write phi of x equal to phi of a, I have written, plus some function into x minus a. Can I do that? Yes, I can do that, because there is an x minus a common, x minus a common, therefore I can write this as f of a into g1 of x plus g of a into f1 of x plus f1 of x into g1 of x into x minus a, the whole thing into x minus a. How many of you understand? Say yes if you understand. Yeah.
Yes, sir. I have understood, sir.
Yeah, please. You don't have to say that. It's enough if you simply say yes or no. Okay, just to use the symbol, you don't have to say it aloud. Okay. Therefore, what will be phi 1 of x? Obvious choice of phi 1 of x is whatever is in the bracket. Yeah? Now let's look at that. So what is that I have to do? If I define phi 1 of x to be in the bracket, then I have phi of x equal to phi of a into phi 1 of x into x minus a. I got it. So first condition is satisfied. Now I have to check. What is that I have to check? Shashank, what is that I have to check?
Phi of 1 is continuous at a.
Exactly. I have to check phi 1 of x is continuous at a. But what is phi 1 of x? It's in the bracket term. So this is the sum of three terms. Let us look at this term. This is f of a is a constant into g1 of x. But g1 is continuous at a. Therefore, this is continuous at a. Do I agree? Yeah, this is continuous at a. Now, it's here. For the same reason, g of a is constant. F1 is continuous at a. Therefore, this is continuous at a. This is f1x that is continuous at a. g1x continuous at a. X minus a is continuous at a. Therefore, the product of continuous function is continuous at a. You see that? Everything reduces to something about continuity, algebra continuous functions. If you have seen my videos on continuity, you can see there I proved algebra continuous function, I reduced to algebra of convergent sequences. See, that is beautiful mathematics. So phi 1, this is continuous at a. Do all of you agree with this? Okay. Therefore, I got phi of x equal to phi of a into phi 1 of x into x minus a. Right? Therefore, 1 and 2 are satisfied. This shows that phi is differentiable at a. What is phi? That is fg. So, fg is differentiable at a. Next, what is the derivative? Whenever we have shown like this, then the derivative is fg dash at a, which is phi dash at a, is nothing other than phi 1 at a. Yeah, but what is phi 1 at a? Look at that. Fa into g1 at x equal to a. Therefore, fa into g1a plus ga into f1a into f1a into g1a into x minus a, but x equal to a. Therefore, that is 0. But what is g1a? It is g dash a. And this is g of a into f dash a. So we proved this. How many of you understand? Okay, good. Next, we want to prove the quotient rule. But quotient rule, I will do only for one by f form, because the other one will follow from the product. I will come to that. So what do I have? I have function f from j to r. I want to define 1 by f as a function. So that means, how will I define 1 by x at x? This should be 1 by fx. Now, 1 by fx should make sense. When does it make sense? If fx is not equal to 0. For which x? For all x in j. Or at least if I want to set differentiable at a, right? Then I should say f at a is not equal to 0. Suppose f at a is not equal to 0 and f is differentiable at a. Notice that if f is differentiable at a, I had already proved f is continuous at a. Yeah, and since f is continuous at a and f of a is not equal to 0, this is my f of a, and 0 is somewhere, it need not be positive, it could also be negative, right? Then I can choose a small epsilon interval around this which avoids 0. Therefore, there exists a delta interval around a, so that whenever mod x minus a is less than delta, my fx lie in this interval. That means for each x, so that mod x minus a is less than delta, fx is not 0. Therefore, if f of a is not 0, okay, 1 by f is defined some interval a minus delta to a plus delta. You understand this? 1 by f may not be defined always. Do all of you understand? Otherwise, you have to assume f is not 0 at any point. But that is not needed. You should learn to be very precise. You understand this? Please say yes if you understand. Quick. Good. You can delete your yes. Okay. So I'm going to assume that now. So what I'm going to assume? So I'm going to assume f at a is not equal to 0, to let me restrict my interval j to be a minus delta to a plus delta. This implies f x is not equal to 0 for x in here. Therefore, 1 by f is defined from j to r. How is it defined? 1 by f at x is 1 by f x. So what do I want to claim? I want to say 1 by f is differentiable at a. Let me call gx equal to 1 by f fx. Okay, that means g is differentiable at a. To show g is differentiable at a, what should I do? I have to show gx minus gx equal to g of a into something g1 of x into x minus a. I should keep this in mind. Somehow I have to manipulate symbols so that I can write, arrive at this form. That should be your aim. So what is gx? Gx is 1 by fx. And what is ga? 1 by fa. Notice that last time I put a modulus, I got into trouble. So what is this? This is fx into fa. Notice that for all x in j, we are assuming fx is non-zero. Therefore, this denominator makes sense. This is going to be fa minus fx. That is equal to minus of fx minus fa by fx into fa. Can somebody tell me what I should do now? Pradeep, Biswas, what should I do now?
We should use the auxiliary function fx minus fa equals
right. Auxiliary function for which function? Namely one function f, right? Very good.
Yes.
Now f is differentiable, therefore fx equal to fa plus f1 of x into x minus a for all x in a, j. Therefore, I can substitute this value of fx. This fa and fa cancels. What am I left with? I am left with minus f1x, right, by fx into fa into x minus a. I am writing it separately. You understood this? So I have got g of x minus g of a equal to some function of x into x minus a. Therefore, what is my g1 of x? Rito, what is g1 of x? Prachi?
Sir, it will be minus f1z over f1x over fx into fa.
Right? So I got it. G of x equal to g of a into g1x into x minus a. Now what is the first condition is satisfied. I have to check the second condition. That means what? I have to check the continuity of g1 at a. Right? Now notice that fa, 1 by fa, this is a constant. Right? And f1 is continuous at a. And f is differentiable at a. And f of x is not 0. Therefore, 1 by f will be continuous at a. Do all of you understand? I am again using algebra of functions. This is minus 1 by fa, this is a constant, into f1 of x, this is a function, into 1 times 1 by fx. This is a constant continuous. This f1 is continuous at a. And f is continuous at a, and f of a is not equal to 0. Therefore, 1 by f is continuous at a. Therefore, this is continuous at a. Therefore, product of continuous functions at a will be continuous function at a. Therefore, g1 is continuous at a. Do you see that? How life is very easy. So what do I got? So what should be the derivative? G dash at a, that is 1 by f dash at a. This is equal to g1 at a. What is g1 at a? Minus f1 at a by f at a into f at a, that is f a whole square. But what is f1 at a? It is minus f dash a by f of a whole square. Do all of you accept this? This is the standard form you write, minus f dash by f squared. Because a is arbitrary, if at all you want, that's it. If you allow f to be differentiable everywhere on j, you will get this form. Okay, please say, if you understood, say yes so that I can go ahead. Very good. Okay, so you can delete the yes symbol. Now, how will I do f by g dash? As usual, assume g of x is not equal to 0 for all x in j. Okay, and f and g are differentiable at a. Then what should be f by g dash? Notice that f by g, I can write as product of two things, f into 1 by g. You understand? Now I can use the product rule. Okay, therefore f by g dash will be f at a into 1 by g dash at a plus f dash at a into 1 by g a. Okay. Do all of you understand this? Then you simplify to get the denominator to be a square, g square. Do all of you understand? Quick. If you have problem, tell me, forget a, then you will write it f into 1 by g dash plus f dash in by g. F into 1 by g dash is what? F into g dash by g squared with a minus sign plus f dash by g. Therefore, take g squared as a common, then you will get minus fg dash plus f dash g. Do you understand? You will get the standard formula. And constant is easy. I should not waste your time or my time. Are all of you happy with this? Say yes. If you are happy, how easy we got everything. It's almost like algebra, right? You keep on manipulating symbols, you get it. Very good. What do you think I should prove next? Can somebody come with a question for me?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
If f is a differentiable, then what about mod f?
What about mod f? Okay. Yeah. Right. What do you think the answer is? You know the answer, right? Yeah.
Hey,
right. Yeah. Anyway, now that he asked, let us finish that and come. Okay, that's not the question I was looking for. Can somebody come up with a better question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes. Jyoti or Kodai? Who said
sir,
yes?
Kodai.
Yeah,
chain rule. Chain rule, sir.
Huh?
Chain rule.
Yes. In fact, in the last word of mine, in the last lecture was chain rule. Do you remember? Right. Okay. So, is it all right? I'll do chain rule. Shubham?
Okay, sir.
Right. Because those are the exams. I am coming back to your mod problem. I am coming to that. Okay. Let us do that. So, it's because I want to finish all the theory first so that we can proceed with a little more examples. Okay. So what is it I want now? So I have J an interval and F is a function. A is a point here. And let us say it goes to some other interval J1 or I. Some interval I. And this is a function from G. And let us assume B equal to F of A. Right? So F maps J into I and such that F of A equal to B. And I'm assuming F is differentiable at A and G is differentiable at B, right? Therefore, I can take the composite function G composite F, that will be a function from J to R. So I can ask whether this is differentiable at A. This is a chain rule or composition. Do all of you understand this question? Please say yes. Does it make sense? Okay, so as usual, let us make a simpler notation. Let phi of x equal to g composite f at x. What is this? This is g of f of x. Okay, very good. Now I want to know whether it is differentiable at a. Therefore, we will use our characterization. Let me write in front of us. It should be there so that I will know what I want to do. phi 1 of x to x minus a. Can I find a phi 1 so that this happens? And so that phi 1 is also continuous at a. Right? So what should be our plan of attack? Can somebody tell me? Now the all of you should know what should be the plan of attack. Sashikala?
Sir, for chain rule, what I have to prove is f of uv.
No, I don't want the answer. I don't know the answer. I don't want to know the answer. Okay, what should I do is what I want to know. You have given me a tie. I want to play with it.
So,
you want to see the tie will run or the tie will break. I don't want to know that.
I can write phi of x is phi 1, f1 of x is equal to f of a.
Exactly. You substitute the using accelerated function. F equal to something, g equal to something, and try to use it. That should be the standard idea. You are right.
Okay.
Sir. Let us do that. So I will write, let us fix a notation. I will write y equal to f of x all the time. For x in j, fx is going to be an I, therefore y will be an I. You understood that? Okay. Therefore, there are two things. For any y in I can write g of y equal to g of b. Because g is differential at b, therefore g of b into g1 of y is into y minus b. This is for all y in I. Do all of you agree with this? And similarly, I can write for all x in j, this is I, for all x in j, f of x equal to f of a plus f1 of x into x minus a. This is for all x in g. Right? Now, let us look at what is g of y? G of y, if y equal to fx, g of y is going to be g of composite f at x. Do you understand this? That is phi of x. Right? In place of y, I write fx, then this is what I get. Yeah? And what is g of b? B is f of a, therefore this is g of f of a. That is same as phi of a. Right? Plus, now g1 of y, right? So, I will have g1 of y into y minus b. What is y? Y is fx and b is f of a. Therefore, what is fx minus f of a? Fx minus f of a is f1 of x into x minus a. Notice that this is a product now. G1 of y into y minus b. Therefore, g1 of y into y minus b is what I have written. There is no composite or anything. Do all of you agree with this? Yes? But what is g1 of y? I can write g1 of y as g1 of f of x. But that's not immaterial. But let me keep it as g1 of y only into f1 of x into x minus a. Now, what was my aim? My aim was to write phi of x as, where is it? Yeah. Phi of a plus phi 1 of x into x minus a. Do you think I got it? This is phi of x equal to phi of a, something into x minus a. And this is f1 of x. But remember, g1 of y is same as g1 of f at x. Therefore, this is also a function of x. Do you understand this? Do all of you agree? Therefore, what should be my definition of phi 1 of x? Can somebody tell me? Ruchika?
G1 of f of a.
G1 of f of x. X into f1 of x. Right? This whole thing should be your phi 1 of x. Is that clear to all? Okay. So, I have written phi of x equal to phi of a plus phi 1 of x into x minus a. So, first condition is satisfied. I have to check the second condition. That means phi 1 is continuous at a. Now, it is a product of two functions. This function is continuous at a because f is differentiable. Therefore, f1 is continuous at a. This is okay. Now, let us look at this. Now, f is differentiable at a. Therefore, f is continuous at a. Right? And g1, you understand this? G1 composite f at x is what I am looking at. Okay. I want to use composite of continuous functions. Again, algebra continuous function is what I'm using. Now, what is this function? This x going to f of x, that going to g1 of f of x. Okay, this function is continuous at A. And this function is continuous at B. Right? You understood that? Therefore, when x equal to A, this is g1 of f of A, therefore it's continuous at B. Therefore, g1 composite, this is continuous at A. Do you understand? If f is continuous at A, g is continuous at f of A, g composite f is continuous at A. That's all I'm using, algebra of continuous functions. Therefore, this is continuous at A. Okay, so this is done. 2 is also done. Therefore, what is the derivative? Derivative phi dash A is equal to phi 1 of A, but this is g composite f dash at A. This is equal to g1 composite f at A, that is what? G1 at B. Times f1 at A, that is f1 at A. But this is g dash at B into f dash at A. In other words, this is g dash into f of A into f dash of A. If you remove A, then you have g composite f dash equal to g dash composite f into f dash. So we proved this. Please spend some time. Make sure that you understand. I'll give you 10 seconds. After that, please say yes. Please remove yes for the time being. Go through it. And once you are convinced, then you say yes. You see that it is very easy, right? All the derivations are very easy. It's just you have to bring it to the form f of x equal to f of a plus f1 of x into x minus a. That is done by purely algebraic manipulation of symbols. Then you have to check the second condition, continuity. That comes from algebra of continuous functions. Therefore, life is very, very easy. This is the best possible proof. Unfortunately, this formulation at present is available only in my book. I think in future others can copy. Okay, now we have proved all the results, right? Addition, multiplication, and the quotient rule, and scalar multiple, and the composition chain rule. All the 5 properties are done. And so let us look at set of all functions we have from J to R such that F is differentiable at A. Okay, where A is a point in J, of course. So what can you say about this set? This set is non-empty because the constant functions will always be there, right? And when I add 2 elements here, they again belong to the same set. And when I scalar multiply, it belongs to the same set. Therefore, what can I conclude? Can somebody tell me, Swaroop? What can I conclude about script F, the family?
So this is a vector space.
Yes, it's a vector space over R. And if you know ring and algebra, it's also a ring because product of 2 functions F is again a function in the family. Therefore, it's actually an algebra or a ring. But vector space is good enough for the time being. Okay, so the theory is over. Now we'll go to some more examples. Let us look at the example, because so far we looked at only differentiable functions. So let us look at some function which may or may not be differentiable. So our standard example, let us look at f of r equal to define f of x equal to mod x. I want to know that it is differentiable. Yeah. I will do it using my second criterion. All of you must have seen your earlier thing, difference quotient, but let's do it for fun. Okay. Notice that f of x, I want to check differentiable at which point? Which point I want to check? At? Can somebody tell me?
Zero.
Zero.
So I have to write f of x equal to f of 0 plus f1 of x into x minus 0, which is x, for all x in R. Right? What is f of x? It's mod x. What is f of 0? 0. Therefore, I have to write f of x equal to f1 of x into x. So, if x is not equal to 0, I can solve for f1. Do you understand this? So, what is f1? If x is not equal to 0, what is f1 of x? If x is not equal to 0, either x is positive, in that case, mod x is going to be x. Therefore, I will have x equal to f1 of x into x, and x is non-zero. Therefore, f1 must be 1 if x is positive. And suppose x is negative, then mod x is minus x. Therefore, minus x equal to f1 of x into x. Since x is non-zero, I can cancel x. Therefore, I will get f1 equal to minus 1 for x is negative. Do all of you understand? So, if at all f is differentiable, I should be able to find such a function f1. This function f1 is unique because f1 has to be this, nothing else. It's algebra, right? Now, I want to know whether f1 can be continuous at 0. But then there is a problem. When I want to say f1 is continuous at 0, f1 is not defined at 0. I define only for x not equal to 0. So what do I mean by this question? I want you to think. You follow that? You should not jump into something. Because if I want to say some function is continuous at some point, then the function should be defined at that point. Do you follow that? No, but the function is not defined. So there is a vacuum. This is 0. At that point, it's not defined. At here, I define this function is minus 1. Here, it's a function is 1. Now, can you find some function? Let us call it some other g1, so that g1 equal to f1 on r minus 0 and is defined, and g1 is continuous at 0. You understand? That is whether I can find a function which coincides with f1 at non-zero values, but g1 must be continuous at 0. Can it happen? You will now learn an analysis instead of some kind of jugglery. Can it happen? Say yes or no. All of you please clear, because I see only three no's. Yeah, no. Why you can't do that? If such a function existed, what should happen? Limit of x tend to 0 plus of g1, it is coming from the plus side. Therefore, its value must be 1. And limit x tend to 0 minus of g1, because it is same as f1, it should be minus 1. But if the function g1 is continuous, the limit x tend to 0 of g1 must exist. Okay, it should exist, right? And both the limits must be same, but that's not true. Therefore, I know there is no continuous function. There is no function which is continuous. The value minus 1 on negative real numbers and plus 1 on positive real numbers. Therefore, what is the conclusion? The function is not differentiable at 0. Okay, please pause, review, and proceed. This teaches you how to think careful analysis. Because the point is, I want to know that f1 is continuous at 0, but then f1, I have found the expression for f1 only for x non-zero. Therefore, f1 at 0 is not even defined. Therefore, it does not make sense to say whether f1 is continuous at 0. Therefore, what do I know? I know for x not equal to 0, any such function must coincide with this. Okay, therefore, can there exist a kind of function g1 which coincides with f1 outside 0, but g1 is continuous at 0? Whether there is a continuous extension of f1? You must have done such problems in your 12th standard, right? So, you see that how continuity is very much needed.
So, how they teach in college is that mod x is differentiable at 0, they draw the graph and they check whether there is.
Yeah, we come to that, but you know, that is. I am coming to that. That is why not rigorous, right? That is an interpretation, geometric interpretation. Okay, but the correct way to do limit will be this. Okay, what I have to do? Fx minus f0 by x minus 0, which is limit x tends to 0 of mod x by x. But notice that if x is positive, then this will be x by x, which is 1. If x is negative, this will be minus 1. Okay, therefore the limit does not exist. Okay, this is the standard proof which you will see. You see that? If the limit exists, therefore the limit x tend to 0 plus of this must be equal to limit x tend to 0 minus of this object. But if x goes through positive values, mod x will be x, therefore x by x will be 1 always. Therefore, this value will be 1, whereas this limit will be minus 1. But when the limit, if at all it is differentiable, the limit should exist, and the right limit and the left limit should coincide, but they do not coincide. Therefore, we conclude the limit does not exist. That's a correct, rigorous proof using limit. Okay, but I use the same proof using continuity with F1. Because as we grow better at BSc level, you should do much better. At MSc level, you should do still better. Do you understand both the proofs? Please say yes. I'm clear your yes or no. Please say yes if you understand. Otherwise, I will repeat. I had given two proofs now. Prakar and Swarup. Okay, good. Okay. Now let us use this to look at some other function. Define f from R to R so that fx equal to x times mod x. So I want to know whether it is differentiable at 0. Okay. So what is the answer? Let us do that. Fx equal to f of 0 plus f1 of x into x minus 0, which is x. This is what I would write. This is x into mod x equal to this is 0. Therefore, I would write it as f1 of x into x. Right? Therefore, what will be my choice of f1? Can somebody say what should be my f1 of x? Animesh, what should be f1 of x?
Sir, mod x.
Mod x. This is for all x in R. Right? For x not equal to 0, I can claim. But after that also, I put it. Now, this is the function. So with this f1, this is correct. Next, I have to check whether it's continuous at 0. But that is same as saying whether mod x is continuous at 0. It is continuous at 0, right? Therefore, because if f is continuous at a point, A, then mod f is continuous at A. Therefore, x is continuous at 0, mod x is continuous at 0. Therefore, this is differentiable. Now, what is the derivative? The derivative must be f on 0. That is 0. So, we proved it. Yeah? Okay. One more easy example. Let us look at the function f from R to R. Because I want you to get used to this way of thinking. So f of x equal to, let us say, x squared and x cubed if x is negative and x is greater than or equal to 0. Yeah? Do all of you understand this? It will be fun. If I am in MTTS classroom, I will ask you to draw the picture. Because many of you may not know how to draw the picture, right? Yeah. This is for x squared, you draw something like a parabola. And suppose this is 1, right? And I draw the graph of f of x equal to x cubed on the positive side. Notice that when 0 less than or equal to x less than 1, less than or equal to 1, then x is less than 1. Therefore, x squared is less than x and x cubed is less than x squared. Do you understand? I am multiplying by the positive x. Therefore, x cubed, the picture will look like something like this. and that will be faster. Right, at each level, this will be much bigger. The picture is not good, but I hope all of you understand what I'm trying to say. Anyway. So, is this function continuous? Sorry, differentiable at zero? Again, you just, it's algebra. F of x equal to f of zero plus f1 of x into x. X minus zero, which is x. So, what is this? This, I don't know what it is, but this I know is zero. I want f1 of x into x squared. Therefore, can somebody tell me what should be f1 of x? Quick. Shashikala?
F1 of x is x1 square when x is less than 0. And
no. No. Fair. X is less than 0. F of x is x squared. That equal to f1 x into x. Therefore, what should be f1 of x? If x is positive, f of x would be x cubed. That should be equal to f1 x into x. Therefore, fx must be x squared. Do you understand this? Yes? Okay. And is this continuous? Of course it's continuous. This is a straight line. This is part of the parabola. Okay. This is continuous at zero. Therefore, f is differentiable.
Sir?
Yes. If x is positive, what is fx? X cubed. What is f of 0 by definition? 0. And I want to solve for f1 of x into x. How will I solve for f1 of x? Do you understand? Etc. Okay. So I leave this as an exercise. Suppose m and n are integers. And let us define fx the same way. X power m if x is negative, and x power n if x is greater than or equal to 0. Check for what values of m and n f is differentiable at 0. So, the last person was asking Animesh, right? Animesh, you should discuss your problem with one of the other students. No? You seem to have some basic trouble. Unfortunately, there is no discussion on time. Otherwise, I would like to solve it for you. But please do that. If you don't get it, we will come back. Okay. So, somebody asked, if f is differentiable at a, does it imply mod f is differentiable at a? What is your answer? Can somebody answer? It, as a theorem, it's not true. What do you mean? If f is differentiable at a, does not imply mod f is differentiable at a. Because we know f of x equal to x is differentiable at 0. But mod f, that is mod x, is not differentiable at 0. Okay, therefore this is false. For continuity is true. If f is continuous at a, mod f is continuous at a. Okay. Now there is one important thing which I want to say. This is what I call local property. How many of you watched my video on continuity? Do you remember I talked about local property? Okay, please clear your yes. I want to know you fresh at pressure. Okay, please clear yes. Now say yes. Do you remember what is meant by local property? What do I mean by local property? If I want to check, suppose f is a function from J to R, J is now any set for continuity, okay? And A is a function point of J. To check whether f is continuous at A, I do not have to know the value of f on all of J. I only have to know if A is here, some delta interval around this intersect with J. Only on this set, I have to know the value of f. So continuity of f at A does not depend upon the value of f on all of J. That will be global. It's only local. Only around A, in some small interval around A, I have to know the value. It may be as small as you want. It does not matter. So similar properties, what we want to prove is differentiability. So let me say what does it mean. I will formulate it as a theorem. It's a very trivial result. Suppose f and g are two functions from J to R, and A is a point in J. And suppose there is a delta positive, so that A minus delta to A plus delta is contained in J. And assume f equal to g on this interval. On this interval, right? Then I want to say f is differentiable at A if and only if g is differentiable at A. Do you understand what this means? Do you have a feeling? This says I have A. My J may be this, my A may be here, and this may be my A minus delta to A plus delta. This is my A, this is A minus delta to A plus delta. Okay. So f and g coincides here. The graph may look like this. And my f graph may look something like different. And g graph may look completely something different. Right? Okay. But on the interval, both agree. That means differentiability of f, if and only if differentiability of g is guaranteed. How many of you understand the result? Proof is trivial. Please clear your yes and then say fresh yes. Please clear first. Do you understand? I drew the picture also. So outside the interval, I do not know what happens to f and g. But as far as differentiability is concerned, it's enough if I know this. Yeah? Is the proof clear? The proof is clear. Either using limit concept or using the auxiliary function concept. Limit concept will say limit extends to A of fx minus fa by x minus a. So when I take limit extends to A, what does it mean? X must be very close to A. Therefore, I can demand my x is only in the delta interval around A minus delta to A plus delta. On that interval, this difference quotient is nothing other than this difference quotient gx minus ga by x minus a. Therefore, see, without limit, these are the same for all x here. Right? Therefore, limit extends to a. I don't have to worry about what happens outside. Yeah? Therefore, if this is differentiable, the limit exists, then this limit exists. And conversely. Is the result clear? Please say yes if you understand. If you don't understand, please say no. Right? Okay. So, let us see. I'll just give one easy example. Now let's look at 0 infinity. This is the domain J. Let's look at the function f from J to R. Fix a natural number n. For any x, we know that there is a unique positive nth root for this x. That's what we do to x power n. If you had watched my continuity video, we know this is continuous. Okay, on all of J. We had seen all those things. Okay. I want to know, fix a point A which is positive. I want to know whether f is differentiable at A. If you have remembered how I proved continuity, you should have no problem. How many of you remember how I proved continuity? I did that trivial trick. Do you remember? I always want to use this x power n minus a power n equal to x minus a into something. This is a favorite of mine. I try to use it here, but then it's the nth root. So how many of you remember? Yes, I do the same trick here. Put t equal to x to the power 1 by n and s equal to a to the power 1 by n, then t power n equal to x and s power n equal to a, therefore t power n minus x power n, sorry, s power n, which is x minus a, equal to t minus s, but t minus s is x to the power 1 by n minus a to the power 1 by n into whatever it is, t to the power n minus 1 plus s to the power n minus 1. Do you understand this? Therefore, when what happened to this? I seem to have lost it. Anyway, no, it's easier if I do it again. T minus, yes, this is yes. Therefore, t minus s, which is x to the power 1 by n, a to the power 1 by n, I can write as t power n, that is x minus a, by this object. Right? This is how the form. This is your f of x. This is f of a. This is some f1 of x into x minus a form, where f1 of x, the whole thing in the denominator. This is a continuous function. Therefore, you can compute the derivative. So I leave it as an exercise. In the next lecture, I will ask you whether you solved it. Okay, please remember, you should do it. Now, before I just would like to finish the, maybe I will take it out in the next lecture. Okay, but just let us do that. Suppose this is the graph of the function. Okay, this is my, let us say this is my x. This is my a, and this is this. So this is a, f a. This is the graph of the function. This is x, f, x. Maybe I should have drawn a much simpler graph. But I should. So this is the, oh, that doesn't look nice. Okay, this is good. This is a, f a. This is x, f, x. What is the slope of this chord? This is called chord, right? All of you know that. Chord joining, the line joining x, f, x and a, f, a. What is the slope? Y1 minus y2 formula, all of you know, r y2 minus y1, x minus a, right? Therefore, as I keep changing x, this is the chord, this is the chord, this is the chord. Therefore, the chord will finally turn out to be, as the limit x tends to a, this is the slope of the chords. Okay, as x tends to a, these slopes tend to what? The slope of the tangent. So if the function is differentiable, this is f dash a. Therefore, the geometric interpretation of the derivative is the tangent exists at that point and its slope is f dash a. This is what you must have seen somebody explain, referred to this earlier. For example, to have f of x equal to mod x, that's what I think one girl said. Look at this. This is the graph. Okay. If I try to draw the tangent as I come along this is the tangent line. If I come via this is the tangent line. Right? So there is no unique tangent line. Therefore, there is no notion of slope of the tangent. Therefore, the function is not differentiable. But that's a very unconvincing argument. But it's a very good argument. Keep the geometry in mind. Okay. I'll stop here. There are two more interpretations of derivatives, which are little more important, little more, no, one is physical, physics oriented, other one is more analysis oriented. The analysis oriented will be very useful for higher studies. So we will review it tomorrow.